Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as a prophet to the nations. You were listening to Jonathan Titilola Olakunle, a prophet and teacher commissioned and sent by Jesus Christ to the nations of the earth towards the rebirth of prophetic Christianity. May you be blessed, edified, equipped for good works, and enriched with great grace by the word of the Lord.
Almighty God, our generation shall praise your name. Our generation shall praise your name. Our generation shall praise your name. My generation shall
praise your name.
My generation shall praise your name. Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. Once again, we are all welcome. We are all welcome in Jesus' name. How many of us were blessed with the ministration of Peter Jerry? Let's give Jesus a round of applause. I think I said this yesterday. I've known Peter Jerry for about 3 years now. But this is the first time we are meeting physically. First time. There are some friendships that are divine. And you need people like that in your life. So that you need people in your life that can put you in check as a minister. Ministry is not a one-man solo thing that you are just running, you are just doing something alone. Somebody should be able to say, that thing you posted on Facebook is rubbish. Delete it. That thing is not Holy Ghost. Is delete that thing. If you need to have friends in your life that can correct you, that can bring you back to order. Are you following me? Ministry is not a one-man thing. It's not a one-man mopo. You stand alone as the Alpha and the Omega. No, it's not done that way. It's not done that way. So we are here once again tonight to build line upon line, precept upon precept, and I stand on the existing protocol in the house already. I want to celebrate and salute every leader, every campus leader present. Please, could you just rise up for recognition once again? If you are a campus leader, a fellowship president here, or you hold any office on campus, please, can you rise to your feet? Quickly, please. Let's give these ones a round of applause in Jesus' name. Thank you so much for your labors. Thank you for your service in God's kingdom. Lord, we celebrate and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. So last week, we started by considering and giving definition to who an able minister is. and we're able to come up with the conclusion of the characteristics and the things that make an able minister an able minister. As I was preparing this afternoon before you guys came in, I remember the woman, and one of the things we studied yesterday according to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Let's quickly go there. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 6. The Bible says, Paul the apostle speaking, who also had made us able ministers of the New Testament. And we defined what the testament was yesterday, right? Alright. Not of the letter, but of the spirit. We define what the letters were, the law, the commandments. And we also define what or who the spirit is, the Holy Ghost. The Bible now makes us understand that there's a difference between the ministry of the letters and the ministry of the spirit. The major difference is that the ministry of the letters brings death, and or the ministry of the spirit gives life. Okay. You remember the story of the woman that was caught in the act of adultery? That woman was brought to Jesus. Well, how the Pharisees, how those men brought her without seeing her nakedness is another story for another day. Because as a priest, as a Pharisee, as a spiritual leader, you are not supposed to see the nakedness of a woman. So even the people that arrested her and brought her to Jesus, I'm surprised how they were able to successfully, because she was caught in the act of adultery. So how they were even able to bundle her out without wearing clothes is another meditation for another day. It's another mystery for another day. But they brought her, and when they brought her to Jesus, the Bible said that they were expecting Jesus to exercise the law from the letters that has been written. Because according to the letters that kills, what was supposed to happen to that woman? The letter kills. According to the letter, there's no mercy. There's no forgiveness. There's no salvation. You sin, you die. The soul that sinneth shall die. Once you are caught and you are broken a law, your reward is death. For the wages of sin is what? When that woman was brought to Jesus, the Bible said Jesus took his finger and he wrote on the sand as if he was writing a New Testament. He was writing a new law. So Jesus turned to the Pharisees and Sadducees, the people that accused that woman. And Jesus said, if any of you have not sinned, feel free to cast the first stone. You know, looking at the Moses said, if you commit adultery, you have sinned. But Jesus said, if you look at the woman lustfully to your eyes, you have committed adultery. Jesus told the Pharisees and Sadducees, if any of you have not committed any sin before in your life, because all of you, the way I'm looking at you like this, they don't stone you to death, But none of them could cast a stone, could kill that woman, because they were all guilty of the same thing. The letters has killed all of them. So Jesus went to the woman and said, woman, where are your accusers? Because that is how Jesus stands as the perfect minister of the Spirit. Because the Spirit gives life. So Jesus asked her, where are your accusers? Nobody was there to stone her to death. She had no accuser again. And Jesus now said, neither do I accuse you. So rise up now, go and sin no more. The Spirit gives life. In that story, we saw how that the Pharisees and the Sadducees that represented the letters were ready to stone her to death. They were ready to kill her. But Jesus stands as an able minister of the Spirit, in which that he himself was with the Holy Ghost without measure. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Stand up now. I will not just forgive your sins. I will empower you to live above the sin. Go and sin no more. So we can't be an able minister if we have not seen what ministry is from the life of Jesus Christ. All my enemies, die by fire. Do you know that God wants to save your enemies? Oh, let's say John 3:16. Don't leave me now. John 3:16. But have John 3:17. But through him, the world might be saved. You need to add John 3, you need to memorize John 3:17, because it makes John 3:16 sweet. Glory to God. All right. So, the will of God for your village people, for your enemy, is that they will be saved. No, you now, weren't you an enemy of God, so that God saved you, cleaned you, anointed you? Now you are in that same anointed. You say, "Oh, my enemies die by fire." Paul the apostle said, "Would not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, wickedness, rulers in high places." The wicked politicians are not the ones that we are fighting against. We are fighting against the spirits, the wickedness that is sponsoring the manifestation of wicked politicians. It's not an emotional thing. It's a spiritual intelligence thing. That village woman that did not allow somebody to get pregnant after 12 years of marriage, that woman, God wants to say that woman, she can be somebody that was prayed for violent parents. But Satan hijacked her relationship, so she became a witch. That's what happened. So when you can successfully see that to Jesus, save her soul, cleanse her, she was not actually supposed to be a witch. That is what I'm saying. So that is what my enemy died by fire. It's not the people that want to get the strength. Because according to John 16:17, the will of God is that every man will be saved. What they are actually trying to say is that the spirit at work, the spirit of disobedience at work in this city that is making them behave in an ungodly manner, that spirit will be separated from them. So you don't destroy them from you separate them from the body that we get sick. So when we say all my enemies, what are you waiting for? You know the right thing to do now. You know, it's not the people that are offending you. They are being manipulated by demonic wicked spirits. Wasn't Mary Magdalene just casted out 7 demons from Mary Magdalene and she became one of the important disciples of Jesus? Didn't you read that in your Bible? Imagine if Mary Magdalene has been destroyed by fire. Would you have many Mary Magdalene to talk about today? All of them had something in their life that they were Peter. God took them, saved them, cleansed them, and made apostles out of them. Glory to God. Glory to Jesus. That is just a meditation from what we did yesterday, just bringing us into it today. So our main focus for today is divine approval. Divine approval. Divine approval. Divine approval. So there are two words there. And I'm a Bible teacher. And I always teach people that whenever you want to teach the word of God, you have to first of all understand what you want to talk about. So what does it mean to be divine? What does the word divine mean? It means heavenly. It means from God. It means that which is from above, that which is from God. An approval. Let me give us some moments to write. So divine means it is from God. It is heaven. Jesus said that which is from above is above all. Are you following me? Approval means endorsement. Approval means acceptance. Approval means authorization. Because as ministers, they will ask you, who is this King of Glory? On what ground, by whose authority are you casting out demons? Please put your phones on silence. I forgot to give that instruction. By whose authority are you preaching the gospel and people's lives are getting transformed? Who sent you? If they have not asked you, it's because you have not yet started touching those corridors of power. But if you want, there's a way you can do ministry. Demons will not disturb you, and you will not disturb them. Because all of you are the same boat. You are the same thing. A house that is divided against itself cannot stand. But there's a way you can do ministry. You know, God's servant, Apostle Arome. How many of us know him? Okay. He said one day he went to Kenya. And they said you should come and look at lions. Not lions in cage. Lions that are just roaming around. The people said that when the lions eat like that, they cannot hunt, they cannot kill anybody again. So you can just come out in your safari and look at the lions. Apostle said, I cannot do that one because one demon I casted out in my body will enter the lion and tear me into four. If you are doing ministry, if your ministry is affecting spirits, you will live differently. You will not be talking too much. That was why the angel made Zechariah dumb, because this, you are an anointed man. Anything you say against the will of God, you will use your utterance to thwart the will of God. So Gabriel made him dumb for a season. When there's a way you can do ministry on campus and micro mini skirt. No, everybody is coming to church. Everybody is coming for fellowship. But there's a way you can do ministry that they will ask you, by whose authority are you doing? May you get to that level in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Where the spirits on campus know you. Because they told the seven sons of Sceva, they said, Jesus we know, Paul we know, but who are you? That is another kind of ministry. Where before you speak to men like this, you have discipled spirits. You are wrestling against principalities and powers, because that is what is actually holding men down for not coming to fellowship. You first of all win in the realms of the spirit, then your conquest there will now lay bare in the territory. In our day and time, it seems to be that especially young ministers like us, we want to do ministry, but we are starting ministry in the physical realm. That is why mini conference in, conference out, you are recycling the same people. If me, I want to do a conference now, all of you here will come. If Brother Peter Jerry wants to do ministry now, the same set of people will come. Nobody is being saved. Nobody is being discipled. But there's a way we can begin to say, as leaders on campus, we will switch the battle to the realms. We will not begin to do ministry from the realms of the spirit. Where, when we have discipled principalities and powers, and like our master, we have made a couple show of them, we now give gifts to people that are free. That's the way that ministry ought to be done. You enter a territory, and the first thing you are doing is be bird and flyer. You are wrong. You became faculty president or fellowship president, and the first thing you are thinking is doing meeting. You are wrong. You should first of all go and pray. Go and check in the realm of the spirit what is holding these people down on campus. When I started ministry last year in Ibadan, I took some time to do prayer work. And one of those evenings, the Holy Ghost showed me that this location you are you still here?
Yes, sir.
The Holy Ghost said, this location you are, the chief prince you will need to fight in this territory is the god of Mammon, the god of commerce. It was like a green, pot-bellied, one-eyed demon, big, tall, full confident. He has been there for till before I was born. So when I realized that and I began to pray in the spirit, engage prayer works. Until then, there are some levels of financial prosperity that we did not enjoy in my family. But after that encounter, and I broke through, the result was that financial prosperity came. Prosperity is spiritual. As ministers, you must see everything in life, first of all, from the realm of the spirit. The way me I graduated from agricultural faculty was that God had to dispatch an angel to teach me chemistry, because chemistry was not my strong point. I would fail chemistry woefully until I was tired of extra year. I was like, will I not do another extra year, God? That night, the Lord now sent an angel. And now in that vision, I saw myself in the chemistry lab. The angel was now teaching me. The physical manifestation to that was that I had a friend, he's a medical guy, he understands chemistry. So I was led by the Holy Ghost to go and learn that particular organic chemistry from him. So Jude put me through. Then I had a C in chemistry. So Jude was the physical representative of that angel that God sent to me to pass chemistry. If that did not happen, maybe I'll still be in school teaching now. Take it spiritual. Don't do ministry in the flesh. Be spiritual. Pray it out. Pray it. Pray. Our fathers have not even opened my book. Our fathers in the faith did ministry with prayer and fasting. A generation thinks that it is flyers and social media publicity we use to do ministry. We ask for our signs. But the things that our fathers did that made them command those kind of results, me, I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. I want the mantle of Catherine Kuhlman, but I'm not ready to live the pure life of Catherine Kuhlman. Another sister wants the mantle of Catherine Kuhlman, but she's not ready to pay the price for intimacy with the Holy Ghost like Catherine Kuhlman. An average young man wants the mantle of Idahosa. Let me, Baba Adeboye, but he's not ready to live a humble life, Baba. Do you know the mantle of Adeboye is humility? Oh, don't let me talk too much. If you want the mantle of Baba Adeboye, is that mantle is shrouded in humility. What is sponsoring that man's power? He's sponsoring his glory. Are you following me?
Yes,
it's a life of humility before God. So you even have to design the mantle you want. Elijah told Elisha, if you can see me, if you can design me, then the mantle will come down. Divine approval. There's a popular car brand called Mercedes-Benz. How many of us know Mercedes-Benz? Oh, you are not raising up your hand. Okay. I like it. I wonder I'll buy it. Okay. Because Apostle Jerry said that money is good, prosperity is good. It is actually good. Don't let anybody make you think that prosperity is a sin. I can't go into that now, but I can probably get my teachings on social media about prosperity gospel. There are five areas that God wants his people to be prosperous. Number one, your spiritual prosperity. What is going on in this conference? You are being prosperous spiritually. Number two, your mental or mind prosperity. When Peter Jerry was saying read books, it's so that you can be prosperous mentally. Number three, relational prosperity. You saw how that when my brother came in, he hugged us, he shook hands. Relationships. If Apostle Selman said, if you need to buy everything with money, you are still not rich. Friendship should afford you some things. That is a kind of prosperity. Number four, emotional prosperity. Number five, financial prosperity. Financial prosperity. But it seems to me that in the body of Christ, whenever we say prosperity, what comes to our mind? Money. And it's wrong. It's half-baked theology. That is why a Christian can have all the money in the world, yet the spiritual life is going down. Is it truly prosperous? It should only come back on lower wow. Balanced Christians, holistic Christians. You are doing well in school. You are anointed by the Spirit. You brush your teeth when you are fasting. Everything is balanced. One side is no, you are not high spiritually and your grades are suffering. No. You are leaders. Peter Jay was saying something earlier about helping, like if in your campuses, in your fellowships, if a fellowship member is suffering from a curse, and in that same fellowship, there are people that are getting A, B, good grades in that course, should it be so? Shouldn't it be that you guys as leaders should pair them together and say, go and learn this course from this person? It is okay to come together to pray in tongues for 6 hours. How about helping each other pass the exam?
Yes, sir.
That is why we are brothers. That is the things we should be doing. That is one of the many things that we should be doing. If Christians are failing, then is our light shining? One of the ways your light can shine on campus is by your grades, whether you like it or not. Your primary assignment is to study. Excellence. It starts by having good grades in your campus. A is a sign of excellence. B is a sign that you are an excellent person. You put in the work to study. So I was talking about Mercedes-Benz before. I heard a story about the Mercedes-Benz company that before they produce or they give their wholesalers a car to sell, they will need to subject the engine of that car. They will put on the engine of that car and run it for 10,000 hours. They are not driving the car around, just the engine. They will put it on and leave it like that. They want to check how long that engine can last. So if after 6 hours, what's your BB? You know that engine, if you sell that kind of engine, what do you think is going to happen? It will crash. So before they can say this is a Mercedes-Benz car, go and sell it, they must have taken time to make sure that every component, every part of the car is working excellently well, right? Okay. And this is what we call quality control. How many of us are studying economics or business or production on campus? It is something that we call quality control, right? If something is not in a certain way, there's a standard. So if that thing is not matching the standard, it does not pass. Now, Jesus is our standard. I told us yesterday that I stand for prophet this, I stand for apostle that. You have not been called to stand for any man. You have been called to stand for Jesus. Because at the end of the day, last time I checked, Jesus is the standard. So it is those that are intentional about being like the standard, Jesus the Christ, that are able ministers. But why is it that our men of God are popular than Jesus nowadays? People respect and honor men of God more than they respect and honor Jesus Christ. More than they respect and honor God Almighty. So 10,000 hours, the engine will just be running like that. Some engines will make it, but trust me, many engines will not make it. So this is what we call quality control. Now, this is my point. If a human being, if a company, because of their reputation, there are some companies in the world that are 100 years old, 50 years old. They are, over the years, they have built a reputation about the quality of their product and or services, right? So they are very intentional about what they put out there. If human beings can be that intentional, how much more God Almighty over the ministers is making? If a human being can subject an engine for 10,000 hours, divide that by 24, that is number of days. How much more God Almighty is intentional about the quality of ministers is raising in these last days? God is not in a hurry. The last time I checked, God does not own a wristwatch and does not have one on the wall. Is eternal. But we human beings, we are time-based. So if it is at the age of 85, you get alignment with God, that is when your own called ministry will start. May you not become 85 years old when God, you now get alignment with God. Amen. Divine approval. So before Mercedes-Benz approves their product, it is subjected to quality tests, quality control. Before a man can stand and say, I am a minister of God, my brothers and my sisters, God has quality control measures and systems that he has put in place, Zaketo Periata, that he has put in place to ensure that anyone and everyone that will represent him in a capacity, in a place, in a geography, in a dispensation, they must pass the minimum requirement of the quality control measures. When we speak about divine approval, we are speaking about divine ordination. So we need to meditate on what ordination is to understand what divine approval is. Are you following me? Consider our master Jesus Christ during his baptism in the book of Matthew chapter 3. You know, in our church in Ibadan, currently we are doing a teaching on John the Baptist. And it has been so an eye-opening teaching series for myself. Thank you, Holy Ghost. So let's start from verse 13. John, Matthew chapter 3 from verse 13. Okay. Mm-hmm. Glory to God. Thank you for reading, ma'am. You remember that the prophecy about Jesus Christ was that, and you shall name him Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. You remember that, right? So this is Jesus now, about, in the book of Matthew chapter 3, this is Jesus, our Lord and Savior, about to start ministry. Many of you, you are in that place like Jesus now. 1 year from now, 6 months from now, 2 years from now, that the visions of God, the call of God upon your life begin to find expression. So you need to pay attention to what the Lord is saying to us tonight. Remember that Jesus had an assignment. He has an assignment to save his people from their sins. A true minister, your primary assignment is the salvation of souls. Yes, sir. These things are basic things for ministry. Holy Ghost, you need to help me now. These things are basic things every minister or potential minister must know, that the reason why you'll be given 1 hour to preach and teach is that salvation will come to the people hearing, that sinners will be saved. The Holy Ghost told me something many years ago that has never left me. He said, son, don't forget that prostitutes still come to church. So forget their fine faces. Some of them still need Jesus. Whether you have a telegram page that you do ministry, or you have a rural a ministry to the rural community, or you are a minister in the city, or you are a minister to teenagers, your primary assignment, the goal of ministry is, number one, they must be saved from eternal damnation. It is to that end that we pray and fast. It is to that end that we preach and teach. It is to that end that we give for missions. And we ourselves, we go for missions. Everything we do is that hellfire will be depopulated and heaven will be populated. That is the primary goal of ministry. So if you have been doing something for 12 years, and in 12 years, there's no significant record of salvation, people are not getting saved, we can question your ministry. The second goal of ministry is transformation. The people now that you have been saved, the people that Jesus has saved, rather, after 6 months, after 1 year, 2 years, are they becoming more like Jesus Christ? Thank God for Brother Bolade and Brother Peter Jerry that spoke today. They said, by their fruit we know them. You want to measure the weight of a man, the quality of a man's ministry. They have taught and they have said that there's no way you can measure success in ministry. But I come to tell you today that there are ways you can measure success in ministry. Number one, how much of Christ are you revealing to the people? How much of Christ are the people under your ministry looking, becoming? A Yahoo boy got saved under your administration, and 6 years after, is he struggling with Yahoo? Something might be wrong somewhere. So you keep washing them with the word. You keep praying and interceding for them. Paul will say, I wrestle in prayers. My children in Christ, whom I wrestle in prayer, that Christ may be formed in you. That is a minister. You know that what powers your utterances, what powers your words, is that you have actually taken time to go on your knees to pray for the people that God has given to you. You want to preach to a man that is chronically addicted to masturbation. You think it's your English language that will save? He has masturbated for 12 years. You think it's just your fine lingo that we take deliver you? We want to minister to people, but we don't pray for them. How effective will it be? Can't you see how Jesus did ministry? When about this time, when everything is getting dark, Jesus will go to a quiet place to pray all night. Then in the afternoon, he will enter the synagogue and say, "The Spirit of the sovereign Lord is upon me." And the Bible says, while he was yet speaking, the power of God was present to heal those that were sick and oppressed of devils. No ministry without prayer life. No ministry without consecration. The reason why your words will transform lives is that you and what you are saying, you are one. Is that you have taken time to pray, to deliver them in the spirit realm. Is God helping us today? So a true minister has a message and a mandate. And the message and the mandate is Jesus the Christ. In fact, I wrote something here for, I believe many of us here, we are still going to end up as church ministry pioneers. Don't start a church if you have not received specific mandate from the owner of the church. Who is the owner of the church? Oh, okay. You know, many people now start church because they saw their friends starting church. Abi, don't leave me, talk. Many people start church now because of hunger strike. It is the economy of Nigeria that called them to ministry. At least Sunday, Mary Loshu, Owo Wole. I still struggle with collecting tithe and offering in our church. I'm still telling God that my reason for being your minister is not because of money. Something that an average young man now wants to be collecting is still a struggle for me. There's nothing wrong if I collect it, but I'm still trusting Jesus to circumcise my heart in that matter. Because I know the snare. I know what I fought. I know the God of Mammon I fought. If you have not received a specific marching order, a specific mandate from Jesus about his plan for his church, you have no right to go and start a church or a WhatsApp ministry. The goal is to break your heart so that you don't even want to do ministry again. Because until you get to a point where you don't even want to do anything like ministry again, you are not ready. Every man that God called in the Bible, they were running away from God. When God called Moses, Moses said that he gave all the experience. Go and study your Bible. When Jesus appeared, or God appeared to call a man, they were all giving excuses. Oh, I'm a stammerer. Saul even went to hide under something because he felt like he was not ready. This is your sharp. You just saw one angel. Sharp. Otilo, ministry. Like, you go back the prophet suddenly. One of the prophet suddenly, Lord, yeah. If Jesus has not given you a specific mandate, go and check our fathers in the faith. Specific instructions. And for 30 years, 40 years, they have not left it. Criticize them, blame them. You did not send them. Ejo lowaro, boko loram. Any run initial aberu. Ah, imbere damajefu. It is the person that sent us that we are afraid of. We honor. We are not afraid of the people that we are going to deliver the message to. Living Faith Church, when you hear Bishop David Oyedepo, one message for over 30 years, the message of faith, because it has not changed. A specific instruction, a specific mandate. Deeper life, the message has not changed. Holiness. That is what Jesus has called them to do, to advance his church. So the reason why they are still relevant today is because they have not disobeyed the marching orders. You want to start ministry now. You are like Amoeba. You are shapeless. There's no definition to what you are doing. There has to be a definition to what you are doing. And until you get that definition, there's nothing wrong in submitting under a man that has clear marching orders. One man that we need to take time to study in the body of Christ is Bishop Abioye. Hey! In my own generation, where every campus president is a potential daddy Gio, Bishop Abioye said, God said that his own calling is to serve Bishop David Oyedepo. If you see me talking about them like this, you think that he's my father in the Lord, he's my mentor. He's not. But I learned from the fathers. Every young woman now, every young man wants to be daddy Gio. Have you? You need to go and study Bishop Abioye. He does not have his own personal church. But the honor of a follower, the glory. If you close your eyes and Bishop Abioye is ministering, you will need to open your eyes to know that that's Bishop Oyedepo ministering. That is not Bishop Oyedepo ministering. What did that man know? He has not started his own church. He has not started his own ministry. Yet, he's a man in glory and in honor. Our generation don't like that one. They don't like that one. Jesus appeared to me in summer of 2013. He said, Jonathan, I love you. Go and tell everybody that I love them. I will be their father and they shall be my people. So that was my own marching order to go and start church. I'm still going to be touching on many things tonight. My own message is the love of God in Christ Jesus. And by the grace of God in our little local assembly this year, that's what we are meditating on, at the agape love of God, the love of God in Christ Jesus. I've said Jesus this year, I'm not preaching any other thing except the assignment you gave me. I know you want to start church, but wait first, pause first. Has Jesus given you any specific instruction? Because he only gives commands to his apostles that he's about to send. What is going on in Matthew chapter 3 is the ordination service of Jesus. The divine approval of Jesus. Because just before Jesus began his earthly ministry. Now, before we continue, understand that there are two kinds of ordination. Are we still here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you for that response. There are two kinds of ordination. And these two kinds of ordinations are very important for ministers. Especially if you are perceiving the call of God upon your life to pioneer a ministry, to start a church. This message is a prophetic message that you will need to listen to over and over again. So the first kind of ordination is divine ordination. And the second kind of ordination is earthly ordination. And earthly ordination is also like an earthly confirmation to the divine ordination. Are you following? All right. But let's define what an ordination is. Peter Jerry touched on that during his ministration. And I was like, God, don't let him preach my sermon. Baba, you know, say, if you preach my sermon, I'll just be saying hallelujah, glory, amen. Every 2 minutes, hallelujah, glory. There's no message. What's the preaching message here? You better go and study hard and wide and deep and spend time with God. So that somebody that's prepared will not preach your message when you are called to come and minister. And there's a madness in our generation now. 6 hours of service, 12 ministers. Why only one? Should they preach message around? But why would they preach their own gospels? They will not be contradicting each other. It is going to, you can't escape it. 2 hours of meeting, 5 ministers. Me, that 2 hours, I'm just setting groundwork. Teaching takes time, people of God. My father-in-law, Reverend Dr. Paul Olaniyan, like that man you said I can preach for 6 hours, my father-in-law too can do it. It's a common trend among the fathers. They build stamina, they build grit, they build spiritual substance. My father-in-law will preach for 5 hours. It will be as if he should not finish. You will be glued under your seat. Sometimes I write notes like 8 pages. Fountain of life. Inspiration. But if you have not taken time to study why, to stay with the Holy Ghost, after 30 minutes, amen, hallelujah, glory to God, amen. At the boy, amen. At the dying long, we continue. Epo titan. So that epo titan, take time to study. Take time to pray. And in the place of prayer, the Holy Ghost will now be even bringing to your remembrance the things you did not write. There are some things the Holy Ghost wants to say. I did not write it here now. But because there is preparation, there is alignment with God, it can flow through me to you. There are some things I'm telling you now. You think that you are the one I'm telling, but it's actually God instructing me. Do you know that as I'm ministering now, I'm receiving ministration from the Holy Ghost? So all of us here, we are growing. It will be very wrong for you to assume that because you are the man of God, you are the minister, that you are the one that is blessing people. No, if the system is accurate, everybody ought to be blessed. Both the minister and the minister. That is the way it's supposed to be. So everybody is growing. Everybody is advancing. So an ordination is, for example, when you finish your study on campus, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, after you are done with your program, you are given a certificate, right? You are given a certificate to go out there and function and practice. Abi? So in that same way, an ordination is like a license. It's like an endorsement that after some years of training, after some years of preparation, after some years of learning the ropes, learning the basic things, at least this one now, we have worked on this one to a level that if we send him out now, he cannot disappoint us. There's a level of competency and mastery that this one has executed over the years, over seasons, so we can with confidence say that this one can represent us. It was after that Isaiah stood before the glory of God and seraphs took live coals from the altar in the temple, and they touched Isaiah's tongue with live coals from the altar, and the tongue of the lying prophet was scorched by fire. When God now said, who shall we send and who will go for us? After that consecration and purification has happened, Isaiah now said, here I am, Lord, send me. That was the ordination of Isaiah. Do you know why Isaiah's lips had to be purged? Do you know why? Isaiah was to prophesy about the Messiah. If he was still lying up and down, his lips had not handle that kind of utterance about the Messiah. Do you know why? Prophecy shapes a man. If Isaiah, in his lying tongue, was given the privilege to prophesy about Jesus, he will misfire. He will say rubbish, and the rubbish he said will implicate Jesus Christ. So before Isaiah could begin to write in Isaiah chapter 9, for unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given, his lips have to be purged first before they can commit to him messianic prophecies. Prophecies that speak about the Christ himself. There are some things you cannot do now because of the level of your consecration, because of the level of your purity, your devotion, your dedication to God. There are some mysteries that cannot be unlocked. There are some scrolls that cannot be given to you now. Not because you're a bad person, not because you don't love Jesus, but he's saying, come up either. Come up higher. There is more to know. But what consecration does for you is that it gives you access into more in God. Ordination. So ordination is like a license to practice. And that license is true. God himself licenses you to go and do things for him in his name. And men too must approve, because we live in a world of men. Even though that Jesus had a divine call and mandate from God, Jesus didn't just set out to begin to do ministry like that. Just like that. Like some of you have done. Some of you now, what you are doing, you are not supposed to be doing it. I am here by the Holy Ghost to crash what you are doing. Yes. So that you can find your bearing back to the thing that you are supposed to be doing. Some of you here, what you are doing now, you want people to feel like you are a minister too. That is why you are doing what you are doing. So tonight, you will lay it at the altar, and it will not escape the sword of the Lord. Before you set out to execute ministry, Christian ministry, there must be a season of training. Christians won't go to an unqualified doctor. Mama Dorcas, it's good to see you, ma. When you were pregnant with our baby boy, who is celebrating his birthday today, you went to one young bullet doctor for delivery. Why didn't you go to a doctor under the hut? You no go grief for anybody. Okay. When there's a legal matter, a court case that is boiling, and there is life imprisonment in view, you will not go and employ a lawyer that can help you to go to life imprisonment, will you? But when it comes to the matters of your salvation, your ordination, the things about God, your calling in Christ, Christians don't mind the kind of preachers they listen to. Because since he's wearing suit and he's holding mic and he's behind a pulpit, he's a man of God. Do you know that not every minister you're supposed to listen to? I want to recommend that as let all phones be on silent. I won't say it again. And if it happens the next time, whatever happens to you, it's not me. The angels have signed it. Because if the vice chancellor you use, if he is here, your phones will not be on ringtone. If minister's phone is ringing in minister's conference, what level of authority do you have to tell people that their phone should not ring? Glory to God. You are not supposed to listen to every minister. In fact, I want to recommend that as a young minister, if God is calling you into the healing ministry, like Peter Jerry was saying earlier, the kind of people you listen to should be tailored to that line. I'm not saying you won't listen to other people because they are apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. But the bulk of your, when you know that the call of God upon your life is to be a healing minister, you will do well to listen to men like Benny Hinn more. To listen to men like Pastor Chris or Yakilome more. God is calling you to be a healing evangelist, but it is, who can I even use now? You have to be intentional about your discipleship. And if I check your phone now and you have like 25 pastors you listen to, you end up confused. My recommendation is at most 3 ministers. Anything more than that, you are giving room for confusion in your life. And your messages too, you will pass down that confusion to people listening to you. Because some men of God will say, tight. Some will say, don't tight. So if you don't even open your Bible to know for yourself, you'll be confused. One of the reasons for wrong teachings and wrong doctrines in the body of Christ is because of this thing I just said. People have heaped for themselves plenty teachers. So Rema has become Remileku. Lorenzo says some of them have turned the Bible upside down. That is what is going on. You can have many instructors, but you have just one father. That's another story for that. You have a father in the faith. There was a time during this heresy, God did not say Noah to build ark. So I also joined the bandwagon. I joined the bandwagon. He's a false teacher. My father-in-law said, Jonathan. My father-in-law, this is coming, Jonathan. I don't know why he calls me. So Jonathan. I don't understand. Jonathan, delete skinny, oh, need it. And the thing was gaining likes. Like, I think 12 people like him already after like 10 minutes. I was like, I don't blow small. It talks to me, I delete her. I deleted it. It was a Wednesday. It was a Wednesday. So Reverend Paul has Wednesday evening service in church. And it was raining. I used my two legs under rain. I took umbrella. I went to his church. After service, I said, sir, I just came to report myself, sir. He didn't say I should come. But after that thing happened, I knew that the best thing to do as a son is to go and report myself. He now sat me down. He now spoke to me as a father. He now said, one sign that a man of God is leaving the scene, that his job is finished, is that he'll be saying rubbish from the pulpit. It's a sign that he's about to go. Time went to turn me. When my father said that, and I was afraid. Fathers might not say something, eh? But see, what they know, you think you know until you meet a true father. You now know that what you know is good, but there is more to know. That's why they are fathers in the first place. I write unto you, fathers, for ye have known him that has been from the beginning. They have the original manuscript. They have the original template of things. The move of God in 1980, you were not born there, they know it. Humble yourself and learn. Is God helping us today? Jesus had a season of silence where he was learning. At the age of 12, Jesus was a temple boy or a church boy, as it were. He was arguing and discussing with the Pharisees and Sadducees of his time. Luke chapter 2, verse 41 to 52. Why didn't Jesus Christ die on the cross at the age of 12? Is my question. Ah! And you don't think about that, Pharisees and Sadducees. At the age of 12, he was arguing scripture, the Torah, with the Pharisees and Sadducees. Why didn't he go and die on the cross as a 12-year-old boy? Many of you are like Jesus at 12. You have started ministry, but you are like Jesus at the age of 12. The cross is still your destiny, but not at the age of 12. Because at the age of 12, even your height, you cannot be lifted up. You are too short at that time to be lifted up. I wish somebody caught that revelation. At the age of 12, he has not built stature. The things, there are some messages that he ought to preach that will become cardinal foundations for our faith. He has not preached it at the age of 12. What he was doing at the age of 12 is good, eh? But that is not in its fullest operation. My son in the Lord said it's like a tadpole. A tadpole, you know, frog, eh? A tadpole. What can you? You can't eat it. You can't put it in museum. That is how some ministers are. They are like tadpoles. They are not mature. They are still in their gestation period. Jesus, at the age of 12, was still in his gestation period. It would be very wrong for him to go and start Jesus at the age of 12. At most, he will have his friend, his 12-year-old friend, that they will be doing ministry together. But he will not be able to save the world at that time. Jesus needed time to grow and mature. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews chapter 5 that we read, verse 8 to 10, that he even learned obedience by the things he suffered. Write this down and never forget you die. Ministry is sacrifice and discipline. Write it down. Ministry is a call to sacrifice yourself on the altar. Sacrifice your time, your resources, your rights, your privileges. And ministry is a life of discipline. Discipline. I was telling Abolade, your president. Discipline. Discipline. From that age 12 to age 30, when Jesus appeared in the baptism of John in Jordan River. For how many years apart is that? From 12 to 30. How many years? So for another 18 years, Jesus was silent. The Bible did not give us details about his life. But many people have tried to tell us many things, that at that age, Jesus Christ was, Mary was saying that he had supernatural things about him. I don't want to stress all, it's not in the Bible. From that age 12 to age 18, Luke 2:52, somebody please. This is just a summary of what happened to Jesus.
And Jesus increased in wisdom,
in stature,
and in favor with God and men.
And in favor with God and with men. That was the summary of what happened in the life of Jesus. From the age of 12 to the age of 30, he was growing. He was developing. He was building capacity. Ministry is not a 100-meter dash. Ministry is a marathon. You need to eat well. He told Elijah the prophet, eat, for the journey is not far. The journey is great. Great speaks about depth, volume. Far just speaks about distance. If you are going to last in ministry, you must see ministry as a great thing, not as when I'm 75, I will now stop ministry. I will now be doing celebrity. That's why Papa Kumi is still doing ministry at the age of 82 or 83, because it's a great journey. Don't approach ministry as a long journey. Approach as a, and you know that greatness in the kingdom of God is not what we call as greatness in this physical realm. Because when you see John the Baptist, you will say he's a cursed man. He's not a great man. But Jesus said, everyone born from a woman, John is the greatest. But if you are in God's kingdom, you are greater than John the Baptist. And the child grew. Say after me, the child grew. Are you growing? Are you growing? Are you maturing? Is your spirit getting stronger? What else do you memorize a scripture? Memory verse. If we do competition now, we are all ministers here now. Let's do memory verse competition. Those are the little things that we have lost in the body of Christ. Sword drill. How many of us know sword drill? Sword drill, memory verse. Draw your sword. The shortest scripture, longest scripture, oldest man, those things, that was how we grew up. And today, our memory verse, talk about one guy, we're a big man of God. Yes! Train up a child in the way that he should go. When he's old, he will not depart from that child. There are potential parents here. We are forcing you to come and pray, but you want to have a child, and you want to pay that child, sit down there. And that child will sit down there. Is it jazz you want to use for that child? My father taught me sex education as a young man, and he made it so graphic. And that night, my father prayed for me and said, you will not be a victim of these things. So if I spoke to you yesterday and I said I married as a virgin, it's because a priest spoke over my life. And that priest is my father. Energy. He spoke those words that night, and my life was implicated. Do you think I did not see 5 years on campus? Do you think I wasn't also tempted to talk to press what I'm not supposed to press? But a man stood as a priest in the house, and he laid hands on me and prayed for me. I will remember that night, and I will just calm down again. You want to be a parent in this LGBTQ world, in this Boko Haram world, in this world where they can even recruit people online, in this world where man can marry microwave, a lady can say, I'm in love with this war clock, I want to marry this war clock. In this depraved generation, you want to raise up godly children, you must be a priest of God. If you are not ready for night prayers, if you are not ready for priesthood, don't even think of getting married. Don't bother. If you are a man in this house, stand up. If you are a man in this house, stand up. You see what you see? Ewen, Peter Jerry Ewen, Chetiri, oh, Jide. If you are a man in this house, stand up. Oh, Jide. I want to come up, party go. How many of you guys are thinking of getting married very soon? Maybe 2 years, 3 years, 5 years from now. Did I say you should sit down? Jesus. Did I say you should sit down? Stand up again. I did not say you should sit down.
You can sit down, see.
Glory to God. The first call of marriage is priesthood. It's not I love you, I love you. I don't know how to even explain this with English language. You have been called first of all as a priest in the house. Many times I'll be sick. Malaria will grip me. My father will back me. And from 12 midnight to 6 a.m. That was how my father treated us of malaria. After 6, I will say, Daddy, I'm hungry, I will eat. That was how my father gave us medicine. I learned priesthood of prayer, night prayers from my father. But that is just one testimony of many things I learned from my own biological father. You have been called to be a priest. The destiny of the woman you will marry, God will demand it from your life. Because you are supposed to use your priesthood to advance her, to advance your children. Marriage is not just I love you, I love you. Marriage is not just let's be sleeping together. It will make you more Christ-like. It will make you more spiritual. That is what marriage is. Beyond the frivolities and the jamboree, it is to make you more like Jesus. You can have your seat in God's presence. Thank you so much. And if you are to choose between ministry and marriage, choose marriage. If you are married already. Because some people like Paul the Apostle did not marry. If you have 100,000 naira, you don't escape. If you have 100,000 naira in your bank account and your children's school fees are not paid and there is village outreach, which one should you invest the money in? Your children's school fees. And that, if you do it like that, God will give you 100%. Because a man that does not provide for his own family is worse than Boko Haram. That's what the Bible said. It's worse than an infidel. You think, before I stand before the altar of God to minister, the first thing I want to make sure is that my wife is not angry at me or quarreling with me. If I come late for a ministration, it could be that I'm trying to settle something with my wife. Because I will be fake. If I'm holding my preaching fire, my wife is saying, Baba, lash your kuku. I'll be fake. Only rugugu. Don't be fake. Be a minister before God in a clear conscience. Have you read that thing? When Paul the Apostle said, we minister out of a clear conscience before you. Jesus grew in wisdom. That means his intellect, his mind was sound. He read books. Do you know Jesus read books? Jesus will always say, haven't you read? I thought you are a Pharisee. We should be talking on. Haven't you read it? Jesus will say, it is written. Matthew chapter 4, his temptation, telling Satan, it is written 2 times. Jesus read. So those silent years of Jesus preparing for ministry, he was reading. When Satan came to tempt him, before he went out fully to ministry, it was the things he read in Deuteronomy that he used to overcome Satan. You can't be an effective minister if you don't have a reading life. I know you know prayer life. You are reading books. How many Kenneth E. Hagin books do you have? And you claim that you are a minister. How many Benny Hinn books do you have? And you claim you are a minister. How many Watchman Nee books do you have and you claim you are a minister? What are you saying? Oh, they are Jabolaton. Kini yok in Jabolaton. You cultivate it. You build it. You can know a minister that has taken time to study, to read, and one that is just freestyling, like Peter Jerry was saying. Jesus grew in stature. His physical appearance, his physical strength. Remember, Jesus was the son of a carpenter. He was physically strong. You think standing for 2 hours, 3 hours to minister is joke? You have to be physically fit to be an effective minister. See what my friend was saying yesterday. He said he went from Abeokuta to this place. Then he went like this. Then he came. Then he. Aro in Batimonike wa lie down there. 8 o'clock in Babaji. Oti remo. And that 8 o'clock, I was telling Abolade that maybe that 4 hours sleep you had now, maybe it will run for another 24 hours again. If you are lazy, you can't do ministry. Jesus will walk all the street of Samaria with his 12 disciples. Walk all day. Their legs is dirty because they walked all day. If you are a lazy person, ministry is not for you. I don't boast about myself. I boast in the grace of God at work in me. From 11 p.m. to 7 a.m., sometimes I'm seated in my study. If I'm not praying, I'm reading. You are sleeping and snoring. Me, I'm preparing food, bread for my generation. If you like sleep too much, you can't do ministry. If you like food too much, you can't do ministry. A man of God must be temperate in all things. Temperate. You are not given to excesses. Sometimes as a lady, you say, this week I'm not wearing makeup. You will not die. You have to put those disciplines to yourself. Yes. Jesus grew in stature, physically strong. And the Bible says he had favor before God. That is his spirituality. And before men, his human relationships. Those are the four areas you must excel in as a minister of the gospel. You must grow in wisdom. You are in school because we want you to grow in wisdom. You must grow in stature. You should have a running boot. Saturday, when me I was on campus, I used to play football every Saturday morning. And then I'll go for evangelism in the evening. So the same guys that we played ball together in the morning, I'll go and preach to them in the evening. You have to be physically strong. A body has now prepared, oh Lord, for me to do your will. You have only one body. Take care of your body. Eat well, dress well, sleep well. You have just one body, and this body is that which has been prepared for you to do ministry. If you are always falling sick, so when will you have the time to come and execute your ministry? Thank God for the two people that God healed today. Because I also had that witness in my spirit that people here needed to be healed. So when you were calling for that, I knew that the spirit is one. I don't need to come and do it again, because those are the two people God wants to address. Because you can't do ministry as a sick person. Imagine Renard Bonke or Baba Debo is always sick. If you are a village minister like Peter Jerry, you don't even have the luxury of being sick every time. Is God helping us today? Human relationships. Agree in favor with men. There must be a season of your life where you are preparing in silence. Jesus had it. It is intentional that the Bible didn't speak much about that 18 years of silence of Jesus. I believe it is intentional. If everything about your life as a minister is on Facebook, you will crash very soon. More about your life should not be seen by everybody in the world. You should have an inner life, a secret life before God. You should have a family life if you are married with your wife and kids. You should have a life that only God knows in the secret. Everything you do, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Abba. There are some things in your life that it's only God, you and God, that will know it till you die. Awon kan agbara nkan kokko ni won. Them Ayo Babalola, that is the secret of their power. It is people that maybe they went to pray together that they will now come and be saying, this is what happened on the mountain. Man, Jesus Christ will do some things to disciples and say, don't tell anybody. Did you notice that? But you, everybody must know on Facebook. So if you want to be an able minister, go back and study Jesus the Christ. Let me testify about my own life to the glory of God. God called Jesus, but Jesus started ministry at the age of 30. God's servant, Dr. Bill Hammond, he gave us 10 M's of a minister. He said, for 3 years of ministry, God prepared Jesus for 30 years. But it seems to him, in our own generation, that people have turned it upside down. People train for 3 years. And for 30, you have turned it upside down. Emigan, Muti, turn it upside down. Muti, Emigan. If Jesus executed ministry for 3 years and he had to train for 30 years, nowadays we train for 3 years, hoping that 3 years will sustain us for 30 years. God will help us. In Jesus' name. After 30 years, Jesus was led to the Jordan River to be baptized. For people, it was baptism, but for Jesus Christ, it was an earthly confirmation to his heavenly call, heavenly ordination. We live in a world of men, and whether you like it or not, men must endorse you in this world. The heavens of the heaven is the Lord's, but this world, this earth he has given to the children of men. Are you still following me? I know you are anointed, you are full of grace and glory. If we cannot connect you or link you back to a man, we'll link you back to Satan. Say after me, if they cannot connect me back to a man, they will connect me back to Satan. Suddenly a man of God rises in Nigeria. Nobody fathered him. Nobody mentored him. Who is your disciple? Is it Peter Jerry? He said no. Nobody mentored you. Nobody discipled you. Nobody laid hands on you. Nobody recommended you. At all, we did not see you take picture with any major minister. No, now in our day and time, false prophets, what they do is that they take pictures with genuine fathers. So you will think that all of them, they are the same. And whereas they are not. How can you say you are a minister and that you are born again from your mother's womb? It's impossible. Thank God that Jerry brought that clarity yesterday. That the first thing as a minister is salvation of your soul. That is where it starts from. If that is not established, it is not solidarity, we cannot recommend you or associate with you. Sorry. If you like, 50 years in ministry, be raising the dead every day. The first question is, are you saved? Who discipled you? Who mentored you? Who trained you? Who imparted grace upon your life? Who recommended, who can correct you when you are wrong? Who can correct you when you are wrong? Proud generation. We are not the one over 100 of what our fathers did, yet we are everywhere. We are bogus, we are arrogant, we are big in our own eyes. May God forgive us. In Jesus' name. We live in a world of men. Men must confirm your call. This is not man worship. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, John the Baptist ordained him, pour water on him, or baptized him. Jesus says, let it be so to fulfill all righteousness. If you will be an accurate Christian, then you must study Jesus critically. I was telling them this afternoon that it seems to me that everything Jesus did is what we are not doing. Everything Jesus said, you're short here, you got our machine, a machine to you. Boom, can this nigga say, anybody know, oh, Baba, this something, you are old school. Telling Jesus is old school. Yeah, that is what you are telling him. If you are not obeying him, you are saying he's old school, that you are better than him. And at last time I checked, a servant cannot be greater than his master. Men must confirm your call. Why is it that young ministers don't like to pass through the process of training? Number one, it takes a long time. It takes time. The reason, the difference between Indomie and Pounded Yam is time. So you can't compare the quality you get. It takes time to be discipled, to be trained. Do you want to be a pounded yam and egusi Christian that your generation can eat and be fed? Or do you want to be Indomie Christian, Indomie minister? You need to choose today what kind of minister you want to be. I settled it with Jesus many years ago. I will not pardon them. My words will be like a hammer. My words will be like fire. If you send me, just give me grace, I will cut through their hearts. That was my allegiance with Jesus. I won't look at their faces. I will preach to their soul so that their soul can be delivered. So that as they hear me, they can take adjustment and their life can be well defined in Christ Jesus. That is the kind of minister me I want to be. I don't want to be a sugarcane minister, pampering you, making you feel good. No, I want you to leave this place broken. I want you to leave this place to cut covenant with God. Say, I will be consecrated to you again. That is who a minister is. That even you yourself, after you are minister, you go back to God and say, God, have mercy on me. 95% is getting also only rolling, you know. How can you be ministering and what you are saying is not convicting you too? You are fake. A true minister has come to a point and said, even what you are saying, you yourself know that you are beautiful. If you are not done ministry to that level, you have not started ministry. Your words must convict you. If you are saying people should not steal church money, fellowship money, you yourself, you must remember that last time you quickly borrowed 1K from fellowship money because you were hungry. Pride and arrogance. I too know I have arrived. 3 people felt that under my administration, I have arrived. I will take nations. you want to go and minister to Joe Biden. Small anointing. We claim we have arrived. Small grace, small manifestation. We are taking over the nation. Small platform. We are here. Yes. We will take over from Papa Deboye. You. Just the. Come on, Shiro. Youths, young ministers don't like to pass through the process because they don't even understand the power of process. They don't know the power of process. Be a way back bella ra oshe. Away no my dear oshe. You don't know the power of process. You don't know the power of staying long in the presence of God. You cannot call yourself. You are going to be praying shortly. You cannot ordain yourself. You can't just go and start Facebook ministry because you feel one angel tap your leg in the night. So the next thing is Facebook Live. You are a fake intercessor. If your intercession ministry is online, it is public, you are fake. God, Jesus himself will go and stay in a secluded area to pray. Who thought, this thing that we know, all these morning prayers now, said people have taken it, people have abused it. If you don't have anything you are doing as a child of God in secret, you don't know Jesus. You don't know Jesus. If everything you do is public, you don't know Jesus. The Jesus that said you should go and start ministry, that is not subject you to process, is not the Jesus of the Bible. It's a fake Jesus. It is a fake Jesus that we call people. I will not say, your own process time is 12 years. Your own is 5 years. That Jesus that you claim that, he's saying, go now. And you have not been cooked, you have not been prepared. It's fake. Souls are perishing, souls are dying. They have been perishing and dying before you came into the world. And after you leave, the will of God is that all men will be saved. Does that mean all men will actually be saved? Let me just read through my notes. Don't pass shortcuts. Narrow is the path that leads to life. Only few men walk in it. Only few men find it. Jesus didn't lobby or pay John the Baptist to be ordained. Nowadays, you can use $20 to buy ordination certificate. Nowadays, just give a popular man of God like 200,000, 250,000 naira, you buy ordination. Jesus never did that. Because I know some of you are planning that you come and sow seed, dangerous, corrosive seed. So that you now say, now is my son, I want to ordain. It was my father in the Lord that says, Jonathan, move a short nation far or more on me, and I want you to be a part of it. That was what he told me. I wasn't trying to lobby for you, for ordination. I wasn't trying to use money to buy my way into his heart. I honor him, I give to him in all sincerity, but not because I want him to. Is God helping us today? The church confirmed Paul's ministry after that Jesus called Paul the apostle. Saul of Tarsus before, now Paul the apostle, right? It was not enough that Jesus Christ called Paul the apostle to ministry. That same Jesus said he should go to Ananias. Eh? You would think that when Jesus appeared to Paul the apostle, that in his way to Damascus, Jesus will tell him everything. So why did Jesus have to still tell him to go and meet Ananias in the city for instruction? Why is it that the church in Acts chapter 13 still had to fast and pray, and the Holy Ghost spoke and said, "Separate unto me Paul and Barnabas for the work which I have called them unto." And then the Bible says, why they had prayed and fasted, they laid hands on Paul and Barnabas and sent them. Paul is a man that encountered Jesus the Christ. Why did the church have to still ordain him? Because we live in a world of men. Men must confirm your divine approval. It is not just enough that you have a heavenly call. You must subject that heavenly call under tutors and governors. Galatians chapter 4. A heir, as long as he's a heir, differeth nothing from a slave. But if that heir can borrow duro and learn under tutors and governors, that is the condition. Signs of divine approval. Number one, you have a personal conviction. Number two, other people around you will witness about that. This is a prophet. Your friends will be calling you prophet. People around you will be attesting to the fact that the hand of the Lord is upon your life. Number three, there will be willingness in your part to pay the price. When we say pay the price, what we mean is that to partner with, to obey the Holy Ghost. Because obedience is the greatest sacrifice. So he can tell you to empty your bank account. Your sacrifice is not the account you emptied. Your sacrifice is that you say, yes, Lord, and you obeyed. Are you following me? The supernatural will be in your life, one way or the other. There will be something divine, something supernatural about your life. It's a sign of the call. Trials, temptations, spiritual warfare. Show me a man that is called by Jesus, and I'll show you marks of warfare, spiritual warfare. Paul the apostle said, let no man trouble me, for I bear upon my body the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is an able minister. He's not an indomie minister. Supernatural provision is also a sign that God is going to commit to what he has commissioned. I was raised in the Baptist denomination. My father is a Baptist pastor. So I was raised as a church boy. And I had the rank of ambassador plenipotentiary. If you're a Baptist, listening to me. And that is about 10 to 12 years of discipleship. Are you following me? I learned follow the master. I did follow the master. I did serve the master. After that 2 years, I now taught follow the master, and I taught serve the master. Those are discipleship curriculums in the Baptist. It might be different from Foursquare, from Methodist, but the point here is there must be a discipleship structure that you subjected yourself under to learn Christ. 7 years following Reverend Dr. Paul Olaniyo, 7 years, I think it is now 9 years now. Following a man, 9 years actually, learning about the prophetic, learning about the ways of the Spirit, learning a man that is accurate in Christ, looking at his life, as he's following Jesus. I listened to God's servant, Apostle Aroma, for 5 years, unbroken in my life. 5 years, morning, afternoon, just listening to his message. Where did you think my teaching unction came from? I saw a man teach scriptures without stress. And I said, God, I want this thing. And God said, the price is, start listening to him. And after 5 years, from 2016 to when? 2021. I began to see that grace of teaching upon my life. The mantle rested upon my life. You will say, come and listen to message. You say, you don't have data. You don't have data. There's no light on campus. Your battery is low. But if AFCON, if Nigeria is playing, you know how to quickly go and charge your phone to collect live updates. Priority, need priority. What you hold in priority is different. And your priority must change if you want to be an able and effective minister. Your appetites, your desires, they must change. That is what I'm praying to God that will happen today. I'm praying to Jesus that men will leave this place with a changed priority. That the things you think are most important in your life, because you have heard the word of the Lord tonight, you now realize that those things are dumb, they are trash. So that now you have refreshed priorities and a renewed mindset. You will now begin to know the things that matter and the things that don't matter again. Things will leave your life. That's what I'm saying. God will have to prune and take away things from your life so that he himself now fill that place in your life. I went to Bible school, diploma in Christian ministry and Christian leadership and church ministries. Many people confound my call, even when I was naughty. Yesterday when those guys came out, some of you came out yesterday, right? I saw myself many years ago like that. I will go for meetings like that, and the man of God will say, you come out, I'm saying something about your life, and he will bless me. Some of them will lay hands on me in front of my friends. It happened one time, two times, three times. I knew that I had to take the call of God over my life seriously. And some of you listening to me, you are like that too. People will just say, live a pure life, oh. Am I making sense here? You know this thing, so why are you not serious with it? You know it like you know your name. So why are you not being intentional? Then I had my first ordination, Calvary Baptist Church, Ohio, 2 years ago. I was praying one night and the Lord said, it's time for you to be ordained. After years of night prayers, after years of prayer, after years of fasting, after years of weeping, you can see now I am a priest. After God now said, it is time for you to be ordained. And I went to my biological father, because my own biological father is like my spiritual father too. This is what God told me. My father now went to meet the pastor of the church. He now has ordained me as a minister under the Southern Baptist Convention. When I came back home, that was when Reverend Paul now said, I want to ordain my sons. Eh? Reverend Paul now sent email to me. That was how the ordination happened. Because that season opened up in my life. But if I've been junketing around, playing around, not serious, not showing signs of seriousness, not putting some effort in this thing, would that season open up in my life? It won't. Some of you are supposed to start your ministry 5 years from now. But the way you are going, it will take another 15 years. If you don't get serious. Glory to God. We are waiting for that sound to end. So when that sound ends, we will continue. So if you walk faster, it will quickly finish. Glory to God. Okay. I had a dream as a 6-year-old boy. How many of us have watched 300 here? So I had a dream. In that dream, I was like Leonidas in that dream. That was the first time I can remember that I have a call of God upon my life to lead men. Many of you, we need to stop doing what you are doing. Let's rise up on our feet to pray. You will need to stop what you are doing now, because the word of the Lord has come to you. You have not followed due diligence. You have not followed due process of staying, of being discipled. The instruction has not changed. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Only disciples can become apostles. I know that you have a divine call upon your life. I know that you have a divine. But Jacob be here for lost discipleship house. Jacob be here, Lord, under a mentor, under a father to train you. My God be here for sinu gota. Jacob be here, theological seminary, kolo kwa or long. Our long belori aye Jesu. For 30 years, he was growing in wisdom, in stature, in favor before God and before men. I don't know how to do prayer points, but if there's anything worth praying about, after you have heard the word of God, it's a good time to pray. Many will need to repent from dead works, works that started in the flesh. Nobody sent you to do WhatsApp ministry. That WhatsApp ministry will need to die tonight. Yes. Nobody sent you. You are running an errand that heaven has not approved. You will need to repent tonight. Many of you need to go back to discipleship. Sheke tele proskatalia. Sheke paruske peria proskatalia. Rela basso seli ampariata. Farunde beruska pariata baha. Circumcision. Circumcision. Circumcision of the heart. God is purging motives. Purging motives. Why did you start what you are doing now? The Lord is asking me to ask you, did I send you?
Fire!
There's a measure of grace that's about to come upon your life. It's like a confirmation from heaven about the hand of God upon your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, from my left to my right, I like the cymbals to clash. From my left to my right, from my left to my right, from my left to my right, let the oil of ordination, the oil of your son, daughters, you are born for me. Let us all be born now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, 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 yes. Let it rest, let it rest. Let it rest, let it rest, let it rest. Yes, 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 yes. Father, so let your body at of grace. Eat, eat, for the journey is great. Eat, eat, eat. Soak in the glory. Soak in the anointing. The glory is always great. Pray, pray, pray. You will not fail Jesus. You will not fail your generation. In Jesus' name, I want all the ex-schools, if you are a campus president, if you are a fellowship president, please quickly come out. Apostle Jerry, please, I would like you to help me here. We don't boast that we have everything, but such as we have, things like consistency, things like a pure life, a ministry without fault, a ministry without blame. At least we know that we know small Bible. We want to bless you from our hearts. We want to impart spiritual gifts, graces, to the end that you will be established. You are standing upon holy ground. I told your president by prophecy that my name and trajectory on this campus is like John the Baptist before Jesus. We are not the real people that we are, but we are not here to sound an alarm over this institution, over this campus, that your season of coronation is coming, that the east gate is being opened, and the move of God is about to be ushered in upon your campus. That is why we are here, to call men to order, to ignite and empower the sons of God on campus. We are too plenty here to take this campus for Jesus. Lift up your hands and lift up your voice and cry to God for a fresh baptism. I say, so pray your heart out. Pray as if the destiny of a generation hangs upon your shoulder. Baroque Sina Paya. Oh, yeah.
Yes. That is baptism of Holy Ghost. That is impartation of grace. That is the anointing of the Spirit. Able ministers, solid ministers, pure ministers, anointed ministers, raised ministers.
I perceive that there's a prophetic word that is hanging in the atmosphere. You see? That is the prophetic word. So, Holy Ghost, I pray that you unlock the tongue of some of us here to prophesy about what you will do on this campus. So I unlock the realms of the prophetic over this campus. I stand on my office as a prophet of Jesus Christ. And I unlock the atmosphere now. And that is it. In the name of Jesus. Shelakosila Paramata. Mashila Kelia. Prophets arising from this campus. In the name of Jesus. The prophetic dimension will prosper over this campus. In the name of Jesus. Let the prophetic gate be opened. In the name of Jesus. Let sons and daughters prophesy. Let the word of God come. We need to interpret that word. So I ask the Holy Ghost again to give interpretation to word, to that tongue. Interpretation, Holy Ghost. Please help us, Holy Ghost. Interpretation. Interpretation, Holy Ghost. We wait. Yes, word of the Lord to your campus. God has begun a work on your campus. We are just here to sound the alarm. We are just here to tell you that God is ready to dwell among you. So don't limit his work. The president, the campus leaders are here in front. You are the ones that God has put the government upon your shoulder on this campus. So it starts from you, the leaders. Are you following me? I know you are so under the atmosphere now, under the presence of the glory of God. It starts with the leaders. And everyone here by proximity has been implicated by the word of the Lord. In your hostels, in your families, in your rooms, wherever you find yourself, you are a witness of what God has done here. And 2 years from now, God will visit again. I'm prophesying now, I hope you know. 2 years from now, God will visit again and ask you, I came 2 years ago. What did you do with the deposits of my grace and glory when I came in 2024? So God is going to visit this campus again in 2 years. I'm prophesying over your campus now. So what you should be doing from now for the next 2 years is interceding for this campus. That is why intercessors were ordained yesterday. Are you following me? Intercession must begin on your campus. When we come and we walk around, we should be hearing prayers going on for the salvation of souls of students on this campus. For the things that will be going on this campus. Charge the spiritual atmosphere of this campus. It's a call to pray. It's a call to intercession. It's a call to be the triggers that will trigger the move of God upon this campus. And that is why you have heard the word of the Lord today. And I pray that the grace, the strength, the wisdom you need to enforce God's kingdom, God's throne on your campus, that strength will be given to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Sir, do you have any word for the people? Peter Jerry. Apostle, sir, do you have any word for the people? Father, we thank you. Return all the glory and back to you. Thank you for that which you have done amongst us today. Let it be a joy of many generations. Let subsequent students, let the altar that has been set up, that has been erected unto you today, let it be a living altar. Let it be an altar that will burn and blaze with sacrifice and incense to the heavens. The lifting of my hands, the lifting of my hands like that evening sacrifice. Let my prayers rise to you. Let my prayers rise to you like that incense. Oh, the lifting of my hands, the lifting of my hands like that evening sacrifice. Let my prayers rise to you. Let my prayers rise to you. Like that incense, that our incense tonight will rise up to your heavens, Lord, as a memorial for many generations. And this is to the end that we cry, thy kingdom come, O God, thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. And people of God say, amen. Glory to God, glory to Jesus.
But Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. I am sure you have been blessed by the word of God from his messenger today. You can get more apostolic and prophetic teachings on Facebook at facebook.com/JT Olakunle, Telegram at t.me/JT Olakunle, and YouTube at Jonathan Titilola Olakunle. Feel free to contact the ministry via any of the social media platforms or WhatsApp at +234 810 970 1955, +234 810 970 1955. Jesus loves you.